everyone. I'm Ellie, and welcome to Sewing Basics. Last time, we went over the basics of your machine, how it works, and we got some practice controlling it. If you haven't caught that video yet, I definitely suggest checking it out before you watch this video. There's going to be a link right up here, so go ahead and click on it. Now, once you've finished that video, this week, we're going to be going over the types of stitches that your machine can do, including the few basic ones, and we're going to be creating our sewing handbook. This is going to be a very handy little tool for us that we're going to be using throughout the entire Sewing Basics series. Here, we will be able to put all of our examples of our different stitches and things. So if you're ready, go ahead, grab some scissors, some fabric, your machine, and let's get started. The first stitch we're going to learn about is the straight stitch. This is the basic setting on your machine and is what mine is set to about 90% of the time. While most machines will set up their straight stitch automatically, if yours does not, make sure your stitch width is at 0 and the stitch length is around 3. These are the basic settings for a straight stitch. The straight stitch is just what it seems, a stitch that goes in a straight line. This is a very important and versatile stitch. It is used whenever you're connecting two pieces of fabric. There are some exceptions, but we'll get to those later. If you adjust the settings on your straight stitch, you can also create a basting stitch. A basting stitch is used to temporarily hold two pieces of fabric together, such as when you're creating mock-ups. A basting stitch can also be used to create gathers. To gather a basting stitch, you simply pull on one of the loose threads and it'll bunch together the material. The next stitch we're going to cover is the zigzag stitch. Zigzag stitches are most commonly used for stretch materials. If you stretch your fabric as you stitch it together with a zigzag, when the fabric relaxes, the stitch will relax as well, and then it will be able to stretch as you wear the garment, preventing your stitches from popping open. A zigzag stitch is also commonly used to attach two pieces of fabric while preventing fraying. This method is called satin stitching. To create a satin stitch, you need your stitch length to be at nearly 0, and your width can be whatever suits your project. Most machines will have a bunch of very short dashed lines near 0 that shows where you should have your settings for a satin stitch. While a satin stitch does move very slowly, it's great for attaching a design directly on top of a piece of fabric. Since the stitches are so close together, they stop the fabric from fraying and keep a clean edge. To practice these different methods, we're going to create a stitch book. This is going to be used all throughout the Sewing Basics series and is a great way to keep a log of the different methods we used. In the end, it's going to look something kind of like this with all these different pages in it. There's going to be a link in the description below for the pattern and it will tell you how many of each piece to cut out. So go ahead and cut those out and then we'll get started. Once you have all your pieces cut out, you should have 14 squares of cotton fabric and one cotton letter or shape. We're going to start by attaching the shape to the front of our stitch book. To attach our shape, we're going to be practicing a satin stitch. So go ahead and set your machine settings to your satin stitch. Once your letter is very firmly pinned into place or you used some sort of fabric adhesive, go ahead and begin satin stitching around the edges. It's okay to mess up. This is your first time satin stitching, so it's perfectly fine if it doesn't look amazing. Once your letter is attached, make sure to trim off your threads. And now we're going to be creating all of our pages. Pair up your cotton rectangles into sets of two. Placing one rectangle on top of the other, pin around the entire edge and stitch that with a straight stitch. For the page that has your letter on it, make sure you put the letter in between the two pieces of fabric, so that way it'll end up on the outside when we turn it inside out. Once you've stitched around all of your pages, go ahead and clip off your extra thread and also clip all of your corners. This will make it so your corners can be nice and pointy. And now we need some way to turn these inside out. To do so, we are going to cut a slit into each of our pages. So go ahead and mark roughly the middle of your page, and using your scissors, cut only one side of your fabric open so you can turn it inside out. This way, any of our extra seam allowance or threads will all be on the inside, and we will have nice clean edges on the outside of our pages. With them all turned inside out, you can go ahead and iron them on a cotton setting, making sure to press your edges all the way outwards. Now, pile all your pages into a nice straight pile with the one with your letter on the outside. In the center of your pages, run a straight stitch. This is creating the spine. Now, we can fold the book in half and run a straight stitch up the side. The edges of your book are going to be very bulky, and you will not be able to get your needle through it without breaking a needle. So don't even worry about it. Go ahead and leave the last quarter to half of an inch on the edges unstitched. That's perfectly fine. Just make sure you backstitch at the beginning and the end of that stitch. This will make sure all of our pages lay flat and create a nice book. So with your book completed, we can go ahead and fill out the first page. On the first page, you're going to want to practice the four different stitches we learned about, as well as a few extra stitches that your machine might have special settings for. So, I created six lines: straight stitch, basting, zigzag, satin stitch, and then two special stitches for my machine, which is a flower stitch and a triple back stitch. So go ahead and create those stitches. And don't forget to write down a key so you remember what the stitches were and what your settings were at. This way you can reference back to this page whenever you need to. And with that, we are finished for the day. Next time, we're going to fill out page 2, where we're going to learn all about different hand stitches and what they're good for. So be sure to have a hand sewing needle and some thread for next time. As always, I want to thank you guys so much for tuning in. I love that you guys are appreciating the Sewing Basics series. This really means a lot to me, and I'm so glad that I can help you guys learn the basics. As always, be sure to leave a comment, a like, and subscribe. It really does mean the world to me. So that is all for this week. We will see you next time. As always, keep sewing, stay positive, have fun. I'll see you all later. Bye!